Hey, this is Joshua, MBA Studio, Minneapolis. Welcome to part two of my interview with Dan Black, one half of the poster studio, Landland. They make other stuff too, but for all intents and purposes, they make posters for rock shows and occasionally movies. In this portion of the Q&A, we dig into the business model of a poster artist, the economics down to actual numbers, which I think is really interesting and can be really helpful, and working with clients. I think one of the things that you're going to get out of this is there's this really interesting contrast in that the economics really require a lot of hustle, and they require making certain sacrifices in order to make it work. Dan and Jess are insanely talented and could probably make more money as straight kind of commercial illustrators, except that the work that they do now allows them to be a part of a community, allows them to work on behalf of stuff that they really feel a way about, and allows them to build a body of work in a way that might not necessarily happen in a more traditionally commercial arena. So have a listen, enjoy. If you're new to the daily vlog here, we're not going to show any cool pictures while Dan is talking, so you can just listen to this while you drive home or something. All right, take it easy and thanks for watching. So let's segue to the business client studio part of it.
Yeah.
What you do is really different from what like a normal graphic designer does.
Yes.
And that design fees are probably the least significant part of what you're doing overall. Can you talk about what the business model is?
Yeah.
Like how you make money?
Essentially, our business model is trying to take the time that we're putting into the work and spread it out into as many different places as possible. So we take the small design fee from a band, and we merge that with the production fee, which is usually a per print situation. How do you feel about numbers?
If you're comfortable with it,
okay.
I think it's awesome.
Okay, cool. So I think we've hit like the upper limit of what a band will pay for something that you call an art fee, and that's about $1,500. Almost all bands won't pay that much. That's like Dave Matthews money. Our art fee is usually somewhere between like $300 and $1,500 for that, generally on the lower end. And then, you know, the production part, we charge between like $8 and $10 to produce a poster, which becomes a hard argument because most places, if this band took this art and went to a screen printer, they could get the same thing made for $4. So we have to, that's when I have to do the legwork and argue why it's important for the person who made the art to be seeing it through all the way. I make a lot of decisions on the fly while I'm printing and don't like having other people make those decisions for me. And usually that's enough of an argument to like make the band be cool. But
so to be clear, the band hires you, they pay you a chunk of money to design the thing, but then they basically
buy
the prints off of you.
They're essentially wholesaling them. I mean, we don't call it that, but yeah, they're wholesaling a quantity of prints. In the beginning, we talk about what they expect out of that, and usually it's like between, you know, 200 and 300 or so, and then some of the larger bands, it'll be like, you know, a couple thousand or whatever posters. So then that's how we know that we're not just getting paid $300 to make the poster. So, usually it's, you know,
so
yeah.
It might be like upper echelon, $900 to design it, but then you might make $16,000 printing.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. Yeah. And that's, you know, the time is flipped, right? Because it'll take, for something like that, you know, especially a job like that where there's a lot of exposure to it, we want to spend a lot of time on it. So, you know, Jess and I will spend a week and a half or so on the drawing, and then the printing, in almost any case, like we could print a thing, you know, a couple thousand posters in 2 days, if two not fun days, but you know, we can do it. You know, in those situations, that ends up being like a pretty good paycheck. I still do a lot of work for friends where it's not really that, you know, it's not that great, but that's not why I'm doing it. So that's, yeah, I mean, that's sort of where it begins and ends with the bands. And then from there, we have an agreement with them usually where we print an overrun of the posters for ourselves to sell at their retail prices on our own. And that's like another arm of income from the poster, which is sometimes it's super helpful. Sometimes it just creates like weird inventory that we kind of sell piecemeal throughout the year, which is nice because it's nice to have a store full of prints where, you know, I can wake up and have sold, you know, a few things, you know, while I'm sleeping or whatever. With bands like Fish or like bands where there's a collector market, a lot of the movie posters that we do, we can kind of factor that into the upfront income because it's as soon as we release them, we'll sell through all of them. Very exciting and very fast and whatever. So that's like another arm of that stuff. We also, aside from a couple cases, we retain like the copyright to all of our work, so we can pull the band names off of it and all that information off of it and use it for really any other thing that we want to, regardless of whether or not they've paid an art fee for it, because it's sort of more of like a licensing fee, like they're licensing a piece of art that we're making to use it for this limited amount of time. So we'll do that. You know, this thing here was a band poster that I reworked to be unaffiliated.
What was this for?
It was a tour poster for the band Hopalong and Speedy Ortiz. A friend of mine is in the band Hopalong, and we had not had a reason to work together. But it was a situation where, you know, the budget that they could pay was not great, so it sort of warranted making, you know, this other thing for it. And then also because we're producing these things, like we end up with like test prints and, you know, a lot of byproduct that can be turned into other things that we can sell, which is sort of how, like, these field notes, the first time we worked with field notes, it was sort of to get rid of a lot of these test prints that we had had, and then we faked it for these ones. But
what other kind of stuff do you sell? Do you do commercial illustration?
I do, but it's not, I don't really ever talk about it, I guess. It's not the sort of thing, I don't really like doing it, to be honest. So it's the kind, you know, with all this stuff, like, you end up doing more of whatever it is that people see you doing. So I try to be very, very upfront about the things that I like working on, and then, you know, the other stuff. Yeah, I just finished like a big, like a weird internal thing for this like bourbon company to try and get places to sell, or to buy the stuff from them, and no one will ever see it. I think it's being like turned into some like augmented reality thing, but because that wasn't my end of things, I don't know. there's a lot of that stuff, but it I sort of fit that in when I'm not doing the stuff that I can show off a little bit more.
And then what other stuff do you sell? What other stuff do you make?
A big part of what we do throughout the year is these like booth events, and I've tried to like make a bunch of just like weird little products to like have for people that, you know, don't want to use up the real estate in their apartments or whatever for posters. So a lot of like notebooks and practical things. A really impractical thing is I started a record label to manufacture vinyl and package it and sort of deal with distribution of it. And that's like this like sort of like Robin Hood-ish like hobby thing that I do, where if a band like Dave Matthews, is that going live?
We can cut out.
If a band like Redacted, if Redacted comes to me and pays me a lot more than you know, I feel like they should be for the time that we're putting into it. Sometimes there's a few thousand dollars left over to like indulge like a weirdo friend in their music project in pressing a record that otherwise wouldn't exist.
To actually press the records.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we outsource it, but I handle like brokering all the manufacturing and all the parts of it, which is ridiculously fun for me. Like, it's dumb, but I really like finding vendors for things, and I really like that end of it. And record manufacturing is like a complete spectrum of like, you can press a record at the wrong place and get total shit, but you can also find the perfect combination and end up with a thing that's like pretty thrilling. That Slow Mass 7-inch is the newest thing that we did, and I just found a record pressing plant in New Orleans that's like brand new, and they're still really excited about what they're doing. So like they were just like, we could do this UV reactive clear vinyl stuff that we have that will glow under some light. And it was really exciting to work with them on it, because they were just psyched that we were kind of dumb enough to take them up on these like ideas that they had. So yeah, we do that and sort of handle record label stuff. I have a like a distributor in Anacortes, Washington that does some amount of like wholesaling stuff, and then I have another one in Japan that does a lot more of that. And aside from that, the whole like distribution part of it is really boring to me, so I don't do the parts that are boring. I try to like pay for the thing up front with these poster jobs so that I don't have to worry about recouping as much. And then, you know, the bands who are usually friends, you know, I sort of just like warehouse the stuff until they go on tour, and then they go and, you know, they sell what they can, and then they pay me, you know, a little over cost for these things. And sometimes we sell them through our store. Our web store isn't really structured the way that most record labels are, so it's like these records are kind of peppered in with all these posters and no one knows what they are. And I had to design a whole system of obi strips, like descriptive obi strips for all the records, because when we would bring them to these booth events, people would think that they were calendars. And and if they didn't think they were calendars, they like had zero idea what they were at all. So I made these strips that go on there that ideally answer all the questions that people would have on it. I don't know. I sort of just make whatever dumb thing Jess and I think is
but
funny.
Like ultimately, like the smallest part of your like fees or income is the actual design of things. And the biggest part is either selling the prints to bands or selling all these byproducts of the process.
Yep, exactly. Or like the weird inventory that we can hold on to. So there's, you know, a big part of my job is also hustling that stuff, which is, I'm fine at, you know, it's way less exciting to try and get people to buy these things. Sometimes they sell themselves, but it's, you know, yeah.
Like working merch, you mean?
I like that, not at the shows, no, but like at like Flatstock, which is like a sort of like a poster trade show that happens in conjunction with music festivals like South by Southwest in Texas, and Pitchfork in Chicago. I'll be standing there in front of all the stuff, like we just, you know, pin it all to a wall and sell it for a weekend or so. That stuff is fine. It feels like a work vacation usually. It's mostly like the social media part of it where you have to like try to manufacture an excitement for this stuff, you know. A lot of times, because I've had a hand in it in like every single step of it and it's not terribly thrilling to me by the end, it's really hard to try and sell it to people. You know, even if it's like a thing that I'm you know, I think is cool, it's really hard to kind of rally for that, I guess.
What are the like biggest pros and cons of the way that you make money?
I mean, the biggest part of it is sort of, it's both, I guess, in that I don't remember what it's like to have a non-variable income. You know, so the amount of money that I can make is directly proportionate to how much work I can get done in a certain amount of time, which is awesome because, you know, like I can afford a life that I don't have to worry about. But it sucks because that's where you end up with 3 weeks of 21-hour days. It just, you know, when those emails are coming in and you're doing these estimates or whatever for bands, and you're like, you know, anytime you get asked to do a poster, it's like a few thousand dollars or whatever. You're like, I could probably squeeze that in the cracks. I don't, you know, like I don't really need to do Easter. I can, you know. It sucks as much as it's cool, but
I do ever wish that you could just design a thing and get 12 grand and be done with it.
Yes, yeah, okay. Totally. I wish, a lot of times I wish that there weren't as many parts to it. But also, I mean, you know, I don't want to just do a thing all the time, so it is sort of nice to be able to jump, change hats or whatever, you know, that's cool too. But it's mostly that it's like weird and nebulous. I think that's like the part that I don't like as much. Part of my business model with the records is I try to tier it so that there's you know, we wholesale a whole bunch of them to the bands or whatever. And then there's like a standard version that is sort of like the bare bones, the thing straight out of the box from France. And then we make these supplemental components that we can use to kind of like raise the dollar amount on it a little bit more. So, you know, essentially like for that, it's, you know, we take a $12 retail record and turn it into a $20 one. With a lot of handwork that probably doesn't work out in the end, but it helps us, you know, pay for the project faster.
All right, can we talk about clients then?
Sure.
How did you build your client base?
It's like 90% having a website, I think, in the beginning, and now I feel like it has less to do with the website and more with like social media stuff. There's sort of like I don't know if it's a maxim or whatever in the poster community that like all these things are essentially just giant business cards, and because the band is pushing them all the time and because collectors are pushing them all the time, like these images with our names attached to them get sort of disseminated all over the place. And I think that's been mostly how we've gotten reached by bands and people. There's some amount of visibility once we started doing, we did a lot of stuff for Arcade Fire, like right as they were sort of becoming a much bigger band. That, I think, paved the way for like Fish, which in the poster world, they're one of the biggest bands as far as like posters are concerned, and they've created an entire culture of collectability that once we started doing stuff with them, it was like this, you know, this snowball thing. And also the management companies that I work for usually have a roster of, you know, a pile of bands that, you know, if we do a good job for one of them, those people, they just want their problem solved, right? Like, so they'll run us through all the bands that they're working with, because then they don't have to find new people for everything that they're doing.
Which we talked about the other day as well.
Really?
Not that specific example, but that a lot of times, like, you think what matters is that your work is excellent. But what your client thinks matters is that your work is done.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And I think one of my biggest liabilities in that department is because everything takes a long time, I'm usually late with everything, later than you know these people want to see. I think when people hire us, they're doing it in spite of the fact that they know that we're going to stress them out at some point.
Is there like lunatic behavior known by them? Like, so
some of them
stuff,
yeah.
Like things that I've heard is I have to drive to Tallahassee to drop these posters off.
Sometimes you can't overnight a thing because, you know.
I feel like if people knew that, though, at least they'd be like, those guys will get that thing.
That's the thing. That's what I've heard. As I'm stressing people out, there are people that have extreme confidence. I mean, you sort of triage stuff at the very end. It's not a thing I'm proud of, but I have a reputation tied to it. I will wrap the thing up in time to get it to the show. A lot of times, it used to be, it meant that we'd overnight stuff FedEx, which can be very, very expensive when it's like hundreds of pounds of posters to somewhere like Miami or whatever. Sometimes you finish a thing 15 hours before a show that's 13 hours away, and there's nothing you can really do about that. Yeah, I don't know. I also drive a lot. Like I do like road trips, and speaking of tax write-offs and things like that, if you are a person that makes this kind of work and you take photos the entire time that you're out there, it is very helpful for trying to get that stuff
there's a twist.
Dealt with. I mean, it's, you know.
I just said don't go on a long drive and then buy a pen and try to justify
that. Oh, no, certainly not. Certainly not. No, I mean, that's usually, you know, source material for a while. And you know, I like being in weird places, and I have now sort of have like buddies all over the US that, you know, I can rationalize why I should see those people or whatever.
Because they'll show you a creepy abandoned house.
Yeah, exactly. And a lot of times too, like if you go to these things, you do have experiences that are sort of unique to that. I'm not terribly like thrilled with like weird like meeting bands and stuff like that, but some of those people are extremely cool and like really fun to hang out with. You just end up in like really weird situations with like access to dumb festivals and things like that, you know, I probably wouldn't be caught dead at otherwise. But yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
So I have a follow-up client question. So like you do work for Arcade Fire as they're blowing up, or Fish, and that leads to other work, or with a certain management agency. In the beginning, you did lots of posters more or less for free so that you could sell them and obviously build up a body of work. Aside from producing like visual output, did that stuff ever lead to like real projects? Because I feel like that would be the conventional way to get started, right? Like do lots of small stuff for friends. And I think there's value to that, but that's, you could just end up doing more small free stuff for more friends.
Right, exactly. The huge myth there is that it will snowball into those people being like, oh man, you've been so loyal for 10 years. Now I'll finally start paying you. That's not, like, you become the free guy, essentially. Most of the really, really, like, free or cheap work that I did like that back then was sort of because this whole thing as a career was, like, in its infancy and nobody really knew how to make money from this
stuff. There were, like, four poster artists.
Yeah, exactly. And they were largely doing it because they were fans of the bands that they were working for. So they would go to a band and be like, hey, I just want to make a poster for this thing. Will you give me a guest list spot and permission to sell the thing at the merch table, and you don't have to do anything except give your blessing? And people would do this work, you know, with the hopes of like selling like 30 of these things at a show for $20 a piece. And, you know, because they got one of them autographed that they could take home, they felt awesome. That's not awesome, that sucks. So the more people wanted to be able to do this with like some longevity, you know, I think also bands sort of realized that there's, you know, for them, as record sales declined and a lot of other things declined, they saw that there was a value in something that they could pay $8 for and then sell for 40 at like all their shows. A lot of that was, it was the kind of like exposure work that I would discourage people from doing now.
So that would lead to my next question then. If you were starting out today, but let's say if one of these guys were starting out, what would you want to know in order to build a client base? Like if we were to ignore the normal thing of like do lots of small projects for free, if you wanted to like hack your way to a sustainable income faster, what would you say?
And whatever, I mean, I know some like awfully young people who are doing this stuff and breaking into it, and they are getting jobs that are comparable to jobs that we're getting. Every time they make anything, they're just like, I'm so thrilled that I got this opportunity. I'm so humbled by this, you know, Childish Gambino or whatever. And you know, this is my favorite thing I've ever made, and I'm so grateful to have this life. And, you know, I mean, it's just, I think that there's a, it makes me feel incredibly old because there's such a difference between like how you relate to your work now than then. But I think, you know, a lot of it's, you know, you just go into it like a rapper and
King of New York.
And people are like, oh, that, I don't know, that dude seems awfully proud. He must have a reason to be proud or whatever. I don't really know. It's not a thing I relate to, but I see it working, and I can half vouch for it. I feel like it would suck, but.
So what if somebody didn't want to do that? If you're like, okay,
that's the only
that
way.
Part sucks.
That's the only way. No, I don't know. Like, I don't know that. Like, I feel really proud of like the parts of my development that are not shortcuts. You know, like the actual like the organic growth to honing technique and the, you know, seeing the feedback follow, you know, like where people whose opinions I trust actually are charting progress that we're making very gradually. I like that, and I don't know. I mean, you know, my honest take is probably that like this path might be a thing that just happens really slowly, you know, and for this sort of thing, I guess, you know.
And it doesn't become a stepping stone to doing something else.
I mean, it would be wise of me to probably think about, you know, like what else I should be doing. I know a lot of people who are like more traditional, like fine artists and graphic designers who want to go the other way and break into doing some of this stuff periodically than people who are trying to get out of doing this to do that kind of stuff, you know. You know, the flip side of that is most of the people I know who don't do this stuff anymore have, you know, some job doing something that, you know, we don't see anymore. But yeah, I don't know. It's, yeah. I don't know if that makes sense.
Is that, mildly.
Yeah? Okay.
So, well, I still do have a question anyway.
Yeah, no, it's awesome.
What's one thing about your industry or field that everyone believes except for you? Like, what's a thing that's taken as a truth that you actually think is not a truth?
Within the industry or?
Could be the field overall. Could be creative work. How do you define it?
I think because the financial model is so weird, a lot of people that do it, and certainly a lot of people outside of it, don't really understand that there's a way to be okay money-wise and like make money and have, you know, but it's, you know, it's because of the thing we talked about before where it's like, it's the sum of a bunch of smaller parts, right? And I can speak from the perspective of handling all those smaller parts, so maybe that might be true for people that, you know, don't do their own printing or don't, you know, sell the things online or, you know, whatever, but I think that's a thing where I usually have to argue about it. A lot of times it's like, you know, when I'm meeting people's friends and they find out that I do band posters and there's a...
Do they think you get paid a lot at first?
No, it's the other way. It's the other way. It very much comes off as like volunteer work. Or like, you know, the thing that happens because you're working with bands is a lot of people will do it because they are flattered or assume that like the proximity to a band or a famous person or whatever is like part of the payment for that, which I mean, it super isn't.
Yeah. So that kind of only really works if you want to get more of that kind of work, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so that's a thing that's placed on people that do this, I think, a lot.
I feel like this next question could be just the same answer, but like, what's something you believe that or do in your work that no one else believes or does?
I think that, I mean, there's a lot of control in it, you know? Like, I think that handling every step of the thing and keeping, you know, most people that do this that have the amount of output that Jess and I do have a team of people who do a lot of the parts, including like dealing with the client's part of it and like handling the traffic of all the projects and everything. I don't know. I would rather work longer hours and have a bigger stake in that part of it, I guess. We did have a person who was helping us with sort of saying yes and no to things, and there were a lot of decisions that I found out about that I was not thrilled with at the end, you know, just, you know, and I ended up doing a lot of work that I probably wouldn't have otherwise.
You have a cult-like following. Is that common with poster artists?
No. Our thing is weird.
Okay.
It's small. It's small, but yeah, I mean, we have like there's a Facebook group that exists that is like, that's mostly probably what you're talking about,
yeah.
Right? Yeah, and we're in a really lucky...
It seems like they buy stuff.
They buy stuff, yeah. No, there's like a weird Pied Piper thing to it that I really appreciate, and it's super great, and it like keeps us functional, but I think...
Like, does Son and Zimmer have that?
Among like real weird design people. Mm-hmm. You know, because they're like, they're so... I don't know if you guys are familiar with Son and Zimmer from Chicago. They started as like poster artists, but they've segued into this like weird, real like esoteric design, like book design, and they design, I mean, how do you describe their thing?
I think they're painters. I can't even tell what they do anymore.
Yeah, no, it's their work is phenomenal, and it's the kind of thing where like you just look at it and you're like, I appreciate this, but I know I'm not smart enough. You know, like I know that, you know, and anytime they make a band poster, they're like, why are you condescending to like make a thing like this for, you know, like, I like to think that like we have a core group of collectors who are into our stuff, ideally because it's good, but also because we're not like assholes. You know, I think that a lot, I think.
You guys are very like high touch with the people that buy your stuff.
Yeah. Totally. And I don't know, like, I think a lot of people that do this, maybe it's because of the proximity to the bands or whatever, but they sort of adopt this, I don't know, there's something really immodest about it that I don't like, and I'm not delusional at all. I make a thing that not a single living person needs, and I recognize that all the time. So I'm like very grateful for, you know, the excitement that anyone has for stuff, and ideally that ideally it shows. We also in the collector world of this stuff, certainly when it gets into like the jam band stuff, like the collector base, we have like really nice people who are excited about our work, which it makes it really easy to give niceness back, whereas a lot of people I know, they just get, you know, the obvious thing, and I'm dealing with this right now with these Childish Gambino posters, where it's like you can buy a poster from us for $50 or whatever, and then in some cases sell it on eBay for $300 or $400, and everyone knows it. And the people that are doing that with us, they're at least like polite and nice about it and like upfront, whereas a lot of other people, you know, they just treat you like a drug dealer, and it feels real weird. It feels gross, and I think I'm not a person that can mask contempt well, so I'm just happy that those people don't come to me. You know, like a, yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Do you guys have any?
Do you have any exciting upcoming projects that you are allowed to talk about?
Well, depending on the, we are doing a fish poster again, which I think is like our 18th one or something. Like, this is the time of year where like the regular circuit of people that I work for on like summer tour stuff, they all kind of get in touch. So it's like, I get excited because, you know, there's an influx of projects over the summer. But I mostly want to try to not work a lot this summer. I've like sort of given the past like 10 summers or so to like just working as much as I can on this stuff, and haven't done a whole lot of like the good recreational summer stuff. So yeah, I think I don't know if that makes.
I'm gonna ask a connective question to that, and maybe it's the last question, and then I lost it. For you and Landland, like, what does the future look like? Like, is there an aspiration of a certain kind of work you also want to be doing, or like a way to like? Or is it more of the same, and more of the same is great?
Yeah, I've made a pact with myself that I'm not going to shave my face or cut my hair until the studio is in a place where I feel good about it. And that's, this is, I feel very unkempt. As soon as that happens, I think we're talking about, I guess here's like a thing, we're talking about like doing book stuff through a place we've worked for before, who is hoping to like start doing actual like publishing of stuff. So I want to try and do that, and then I feel like at the end of doing like a big monograph book thing, it'll either feel like doing more of the same is a good idea, or it'll feel like we've capped a certain phase, right? And then it'll reveal itself what the next thing is to do. But mostly I just want to get that document of like the past like 12 years or so locked in and see. But yeah, I'd be content. I mean, I have like carpal tunnel problems from drawing and stuff, but it, aside from that, I think that it's like it's sustainable, surprisingly, and that's not the case for a lot of people that do this. So yeah, I don't know. I feel good about it.
Cool.
Yeah, I don't know. Incremental changes.
Nice.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Dan.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. I brought field notes for you guys, if you want. If
they're
you
limited to 11,000
copies. Yeah, they're real limited.
I opened one up today. Can you hit the button on that?
Oh, yeah.